pray today. I was praying for this time. I was praying for you, praying for our pastor, for our brothers in Honduras. They are very good. Do you still wear your pictures?
Yes.
Yes. It looks nice in Honduras. It's very nice. Monica! Stay there, also Monica. I wanted to introduce my dad. He's from Peru. He's visiting me. He's a pastor for 40 years in Peru. Yeah. And sometimes he came to me. He came here to visit me, to help me with my church, Spanish ministry, Spanish church. And he's with us. And okay, papi. He's a pastor. Next, we are the population is at 29 million Peruvians. 29 million. I think we are already at 30 million. The official religion is a Catholic, the official religion. But the good news is the church, the Christians, Pentecostal especially, we are growing up a lot. We are growing and growing and growing. I think the most people, Catholic people, they are going to move into Pentecostal church. Because it's different. We feel the Holy Spirit. We worship the Holy Spirit. And we are freedom to worship to the Holy Spirit. Catholic, no, Catholic is like that, very calm, very quiet, very serious, right? We are different because we are worshiping alive God, alive Jesus. He's your God. He's my God. Amen. Next slide. That is a Catholic. They worship the evil idol. They have idol, and thousand people goes to worship them. And you know what? They have to walk very long distance, very long way, like that, worshiping their God. And they walk. Maybe 1, 2, 3 miles. And it's interesting then, because they worship their God and their knees. And when you are coming here, you don't want to at least raise your hand. You don't want to worship loud. You don't want to come to the altar and say, I am here surrounding you. It's interesting, right? While other people are worshiping God, surrender in their knees, raising their hands, their arms, you are like that. Next slide, baby. Machu Picchu! This is the seven marvelous, wonderful in the world. I don't know if I said good. But you understand me. Machu Picchu, if you have opportunity to go over there, you are welcome to my country. You can sleep in my house and sleep in my bed. You are welcome. Okay? Next slide. That is Lima, Peru. You see the buildings on the above. The sea is very low. Next slide. Cuy, have you seen that before? Cuy. That is an English, it's a guinea pig. That is a pet. It's a mascota. How do you say mascota? A pet right here in Peru is food. For real. In Peru is food. It is good. Delicious. Tastes like a rat. Yeah? It is good. Next slide. You can eat like that, or you can eat like, next slide. It's frosty. Oh, like that. If you are welcome to Peru, you have to eat that. No, he's kidding. My name is Cuy, and we all Peruvians guys eat that. I'm sorry if it's your pet. Don't remind me you have, because if I go, I'm gonna eat your pet. Okay? I'm gonna eat in your pet. I don't remind you. Next slide. House and kids. Look at the house. House in Peru. Very close together in the mountain. No trees. No. It's not green like this. Like here, it's different. Like a desert. They live together in the mountains. Like a desert. Look at the house. Yeah. Look at the house. One of that is my house. For real. One of them, or of that, or those, is my house. That is poor place. They live like that. People eating in the floor. It's poor people. Usually in my church, we give them a breakfast for kids, for mothers. My dad's church, they give them a breakfast in the mornings, especially weekends. Next slide. Kids selling popcorn in the street. Next slide. Kids cleaning chairs, working like that. Next. Sometimes kids go to the trash to pick up food or some stuff to use in Peru. The verse Proverbs 19:17 says, "He who has pity on the poor lends to the Lord, and he will pay back what he has given." If you help some poor people, God is going to give you that back. Amen. You are going to give it in the good land. So don't forget the Bible says we have to lend to help. Poor, because there is another poor people worse than you, worse than me. It's the Bible says. He who has been pity on the poor lend to the Lord, and he will pay back what he has given. Amen? That is some pictures about my country to know me a little bit more, who am I, where I come from. And I am here because God has a purpose with me. You are here because God has a purpose with you. It's not casuality, you are here. If you have your Bible in Nehemiah chapter 4, verse 1 and 2. Nehemiah chapter 4, verse 1 and 2. We are going to read only these two verses. chapter 4, verse 1 and 2. Nehemiah chapter 4, verse 1 and 2. You see the Bible already? The Bible said, before I read this verse, those verses, many years ago, Nehemiah was in the palace. Good, you're gonna help me. In the palace, he was very comfortable. Man, that word is very hard for me to say. Comfortable. Very good. Comfortable. Nehemiah was very comfortable in the palace. He was making good money. He was helping the king. He was everything. Food, clothes, good money, good pay. He was comfortable. But one day, God called him to move. God called him to move and said, Nehemiah, you have to leave. You have to leave the palace. Why you have to leave? I am very good here. I'm doing good. I am making good money. I have my house, my place. I have everything. What, God? Why I have to move? Nehemiah, because I am your God, and you are going to obey.
Amen.
And you are going to build the walls of Jerusalem. That is not good. I have to work hard. I have to leave all my stuff here, all my cars, all my money, all my job, my good job. And you want me to go to build the wall of Jerusalem? Yes. It's very hard to leave, to move when you are comfortable. You have to leave your family, your good job, your good place. But let me tell you, when God is telling you, when God is speaking to you, and He is to ordain, you have to do it. You have to obey. We have. And Nehemiah left everything and he went another place to build the walls of Jerusalem. And many people followed him. You know what? It wasn't easy for him. Because he has one enemy. Let's read Nehemiah chapter 4, number 1 and 2. And say, but it so happened when Sambalat, he's the enemy, heard that we were rebuilding the wall, that he was furious and very indignant. And mocked the Jews. Jews, I said, Jews. beside Pastor Jeremy. He's doing good. Until now. Amen. Verse 2. But before verse 2, there is a four questions that Sambalat made. Sambalat was the enemy. He didn't want that Nehemiah rebuild the walls. And he got angry. He was upset. Sambalat represents our enemy. Sometimes when God's calling you, sometimes when God sends you to do something for him, the enemy, your enemy, is going to get mad. And he's going to do anything to stop you. To stop you. Verse 2. And he spoke, Sambalat. And he spoke before his brethren and the army of Samaria and said, "What are these feeble youths doing? Will they fortify themselves? Will they offer sacrifice? Will they complete it in a day? Will they revive the stones from the heaps of rubbish? Stones that are buried." Sambalat was angry. Sambalat was mad. And he asked their people and myself and them with itself, he said, four questions. We can read in the scripture. Four questions that he did. Four questions. It's the same thing with you. It's the same thing happens with us. The enemy are going to ask you, put in your mind, questions. Questions. Are you okay? Are you sure you want to do it? Are you sure it's God telling you? Are you sure you are following your heart? And he put in your mind, do that. How do you say do that? Doubt. And you doubt a lot. First question. What are these feeble youths doing? Feeble is weak. Sometimes the enemy is going to call you feeble, weak. You are weak. You are not a strong person. You are not a strong Christian. You are weak. And when you come to church, he's going to tell you, what are you doing here? Maybe you are going to receive a lot of spiritual strength. But when you go out, the enemy is going to keep telling you, you are weak. Sambalat called them, you are weak. You are not going to do nothing. You are feeble. My brothers and sisters, when Sambalat, when your enemy called you weak, when he put on your mind that you are weak, you are going to rebuke. Amen. You are going to rebuke that word. Yes. your partner called you weak. Maybe your, even your family, your wife, you are a weak man. You are a weak husband. Rebuke! Because the word of God doesn't say that. What does it say? Joel 3:10. Joel 3:10. Sister Gwen. Joel 3:10. Give me the microphone, please. Let me tell you, you are a strong guy. You are a strong Christian. Joel 3:10. I am strong. From now on, you have to call you by yourself. I am strong. I am strong in Jesus Christ. I am strong because God gave me God, made me a strong guy. We are a strong people because we believe in a strong God. You are not weak anymore. Rebuke when the Satan, when your enemy called you. What the word say? 2 Corinthians 12:9-10. The Bible said you are strong. You are not weak anymore. Will they offer sacrifice? In my Bible, there is a 4 questions, okay? So the second question for me is, in the Bible, will they offer sacrifice? Sambalat asked them, are you going to sacrifice your God? Sacrifice means, you know what means sacrifice? Worship. Worship God. Worship our God. Worship my God. And your enemy and my enemy doesn't lie when we worship God. He doesn't lie when you say, this Sunday I am going to church to worship my God. The enemy is going to put in your mind, on your mind, and he's going to tell you, you are going to worship God. All this week, you were being a bad person. You were fighting with your wife, with your husband. You did mistakes in your job. You are a sinner, and you are going to worship God. And when you got here, and you want to worship God, he's going to keep telling you. Worship? Why you worship? Why are you going to worship? Don't feel stupid. Don't raise your hand. Don't go to the altar. Why? You are a sinner. You logical, hypocrite. He hates when you worship God. Sambalat was mad and he said, are they going to worship God? No, they are not going to do that. So please, even you feel bad, even you feel sad, when you feel sad, when you feel bad, when you feel weak, when you feel that you did mistakes, when you feel you did bad things during the week, still worship God. Amen. Still worship God. He's going to receive the worship. He's going to receive the worship because David, he was very sad. He felt very sinner. He was very, very repentant. And he was crying. In his worst moment, he worshiped God and he wrote this verse. Psalms 51, 10 to 15, Sister Anna. Psalms 51, 10 to 15, what it says. It says, Psalms 51, 10 to 15.
Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and uphold in me by your generous spirit. Then I will reach transgressors your way, and sinners shall be converted to you. Deliver me from the guilt of bloodshed, O God, the God of my salvation, and my tongue shall sing out loud your righteousness. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth shall now forth your praise.
When you feel in the worst moment, still worship God and read that scripture. David was in the worst moment. He was very sad. He felt very sinner. And he wrote that verse. Because he was his sinner with Bathsheba. Question number three. Will they complete in a day? Will they complete it in a day? So he said, are they going to do it? Are they going to be in the world? I don't think so. Are they going to do it in a day? The day means in short time. In other words, Sambala didn't believe that they, Nehemiah and his people, they're going to do it. They were going to do it. Sometimes our enemy is telling me, you are not going to complete. You are not going to do it. You are not going to finish. But God put it in your heart. The enemy is going to tell you, you are not going to complete the purpose God in your life. You are not going to finish. He forgives you already. Sometimes he is going to tell us, you are not going to do it. The future that God made for you, that God made it for you, that God blessed have it for you, you are not going to take it. You are not going to do it. If he's going to put you, how do you say when you put in your freezer, in your fridge, different papers to remind, sticky papers?
Yes.
Sticky papers? He's going to put the sticky papers different ways, different parts. In your car, in your room, in your house, in your car, in your job, in your mind, like a sticky papers. You are not going to do it. You are not going to finish. God's purpose is done. No, not anymore for you. The devil, that Sambalat, he's going to put that in our mind, just in our mind. So don't listen. The sticky papers that enemy put in front of you. Nehemiah went to build the walls. God called him to do it. You know what? He did it.
Amen.
Even Sambalat didn't want, he did it. Because God was with him.
Amen.
God is with me.
Yes.
God is with him.
Yes.
God is with us. And he's going to do it. He's going to finish with us.
Yeah.
He's going to finish the plans God for your life, for your family, for your job, for our church.
Amen.
Question number 4 and the last question. Will they revive the stones from the heaps of rubbish? Stones that are buried. So there is no stones. There is no stones, rocks. How are they going to build the wall? There is no rocks anywhere. But you know what? Even Nehemiah didn't see stones and rocks. God provide. God provide the stones and the rocks. Because the purpose God has to finish. Maybe you don't see rocks around you. Maybe you don't see stones around you. Maybe you don't see nothing around you. But When God called you, when God told you, He is going to do it. And He's going to provide the rights and the stones. And you are going to do it. We are going to do it. Because you know number six. What said number six? Number six. 4, 6, 7. So we build the wall. And the entire wall was joined together up to have its height. For the people had a mind to work. Sometimes you are not going to see that. I remember in 2013, 2 years ago, Spanish ministry, our church day, I felt very sad and I said, I'm gonna go, I'm gonna leave. Because in 2013, my people to help me, my musicians, they left. Drummer, everywhere, they left. Church, empezó a start to going down, decline. I was getting frustrated. People doesn't come anymore. There's a couple of families. I start to pray, to fast, and little by little, God started to go in church again. No musician came to me and said, Pastor, I can play the piano. Pastor, I can sing. Pastor, I can get the drums. I can work. I said, thank you. When you don't see nothing, sometimes He's going to provide. So now, 2014, I see that glory of God in my church. People come to hear, to say, today I am going to baptize five people. My last Sunday, we had anniversary, 4 years. Bunch of Catholic people came to me and I said, I feel good here. When I was in the Catholic church, I didn't feel nothing. I don't feel nothing over there. I like here, I feel something. I don't know what is that. I said, it's the Holy Spirit in your head. It's the Holy Spirit working with you. It's the Holy Spirit moving you. That's the Holy Spirit. So now I can see the world building. The world is building. My brothers, my sister, my friends, the world in your life is going to build. It's going to build. To rebuild. If it was destroyed, now from now on it's going to rebuild. Thank you. And believe it. Amen? So let's worship. I love the worship. I worship the word. Come here, singing. Singing. The song. I want more of you. I like the song. I want more of you. I want more of you. My brothers, my sisters, my partners, my friends. Number one, we are no weak anymore. Number two, we are worshipers. Number three, we are going to finish God's purpose. Number four, God is going to provide the stones for build the wall. For build the wall. You see number six? They finish. They did. Nehemiah and his people did it. Even though even Sambalat did it one, Nehemiah did it, and we are going to do it.
Amen.
Let's worship.
God, I thank you for what you've done in this house today. God, I ask that you would just move in us,
God, that you would seal the word that you place inside of our hearts, God, and that everything that you've done in this place would not be in vain, but God, we would walk in it the rest of this week, and we would use it as a propeller, God, to just send us forth into this week, and that we would just walk in you, and we would move with you, and that we would listen to your voice, and we would hear you speak, and we would obey. God, I thank you, Father, that you have moved in us, and that you would fortify the walls that are around us, God, that you would build us back up, God, every broken piece, everything that's fallen off, every life situation that has caused us to stumble and to crumble and fall to pieces, God, I thank you, God, that you are fortifying the walls that are around us right now. God, that your Holy Spirit would build us back up, God, that the strength that we need and the courage that we need, God, it's there because you're there, God, that you are propelling us on, that you're moving us into our future, God. I thank you, Father, for what you're doing in this place. God, I ask that you would touch every single person here, God, that they would be blessed, that their lives would be blessed, that this week, God, you would just cause extraordinary things to happen in their lives, God, because of their obedience and their servant to you, God. I thank you, Father, for this house. God, I thank you for our pastor and for this missions team. God, right now we send a word to them, God, that you would take care of them, that everything that they put their hands to do this week would be blessed. In the name of Jesus, God, that every person that they come in contact with would feel the love of Jesus, that they would know you, and that they would want to know you more. In the name of Jesus, we pray, and everybody said, amen. Y'all have a great day of being prayer.